Thank you to all of you, and thank you to the Oak Kwan to receive me as a French visitor in Alaska. Thank you to all of you also, because I know the worst enemy of a presenter is a sun. And as I understand that there is not so often the sun, so thank you in Alaska, thank you for being here. Yes, as Cathy said, I first came in Alaska in 2001 as a captain of a cruise ship, and every year I was coming in Alaska in 2009 until 2009. So it makes some strong marks on me, of course, 9 years of Alaska, and but it was very, very positive. And indeed, when the pilot John Baldry talked to me about La Perouse, I have to be honest and to say I didn't know him very well. And when John asked me, so your colleague, French colleague, came to Alaska, I was thinking to Cousteau, maybe. I said, Cousteau? Ah, no, it's much older. And he is the one who told me La Perouse. And I said, okay, so I will learn my my lessons, and I will see what I can do. And I have to say that every time I came in Alaska, I was very, very warmly welcomed. And this is how now we have a very good friends with many, many people. We have exchanged from Alaska to France, France to Alaska. Even it's not very easy to be friend with the Frenchies, because it's very far. Anyway, so we will go ahead with La Perouse. So La Perouse was a French French noble who was born in the 18th century, exactly in 1741 in France. He was born in Albi, a very nice city, southwest of France. There is good wine here also, good food, of course. And was from Albi. And this city that is now more and more famous, as it is, it has been elected by UNESCO as a city, historical city. This is also a city where was born Toulouse-Lautrec, the famous painter. So he was born in this small castle, the Chateau d'Hugo, family castle, that is still owned by the family of La Perouse, by the descendants of his sisters, because La Perouse has never any kids. He was a seaman, and maybe he has kids all around the world, but not the official one here. Yeah, this time the seamen, they were living for 2 years or 3 years, and even more, and you see, he never even came back home. So he decided at a very early age to be a seaman. So it was in the 1756 when he decided to be a seaman. And 1756 is a very important date, at least in France, because a man you may know, Voltaire. Voltaire was born in 1694 and died in 1778. Diderot, another French philosopher, he was born in 1713 and died in 1784. D'Alembert, another one, 1777 until 1783. And Rousseau, another very famous one, from 1712 to 1778. So La Perouse was born in this period of time where these four French philosophers were trying to build what we call le siècle des Lumières in France. And there were a lot of questions about what is a human people? Are they all equal? Are some better than the other one? And a lot of big questions about humanity. And he was born, La Perouse was born just during this time. So at the age of 15, so he reached Brest, a city in the very west part of France, in Brittany, to be a sailor, a military sailor. At this time, to be a military sailor, to be a captain, and to be at school, at the maritime school, you had to pay your school, you had to pay for your uniform, you had to pay for your food, you had to pay for everything. So his father gave him a farm, and this farm allows him to have some revenues to be able to pay for the school. So he went to this school in Brest, and at the age of 16, he was sent immediately on some warship to train and to learn the job. And at this time, you can imagine that he had many opportunities to learn the job, because as you may know, French and English, they are very friend, but the best friend may fight very hard together. And it's a tradition between English and French. Yes, we fight a lot, a lot. So La Perouse had a lot of opportunities to learn his job, a lot, a lot. So at first, so at the age of 16, he was engaged in a fight, in Brittany, in the west of France, and he was very seriously wounded, and he was as a prisoner from the English. After 1 year of jail in England, so he was freed. But you imagine at 16 years old, when you see this kind of situation, with the guns from one ship to another one, with the big bullets hitting people. So you have the head going on one side, the arms in other directions. So it was quite a bloody situation. So at 16 years old, it had a big impact on his mind. So keeping in mind that there was all these big discussions, this philosophical discussion, plus this, you may imagine that he said, okay, never again, never again. But he was not the one who was deciding if it was never again or not. So in after some period of peace between England and France, so he went back again and in 73, so at the age of 31 years old, he went in Indian Ocean. Because in Indian Ocean, France had some possessions, had some ports, and of course, where the French are, English are. And the English, so French and English, once again, they were fighting together. And English trying to kick off the French from there. So he was fighting again and again. And he went... after this period of time, he went back to France, and there was a period of calm between France and England, and he was at this time captain of a commercial ship, let's say. So he was still continuing to perform his experience, to improve his experience of a seaman, until the 1778. What happened in 1778? You should know, you should teach me. Yes, there was this insurrection in the east of the United States, not yet the United States. And of course, as the French were too happy to help you, it was nice. So La Perouse, of course, was engaged again against the English. So he participated a lot to the to your independence, and he defeated many English ship, and he had several special mission that was given to him. For instance, not only to fight on the east coast of America, but to try to find where the English interest could be affected. So he was sent in Hudson Bay, in very, very north, in Hudson Bay, where there were two English forts And this English forts were protecting some hunter, some English people going to catch the fur of the sea lions, the seals and bears and so, because it was a very, very profitable business. So they sent La Perouse to try to hit this business and to have a psychological effect on the English, to tell them, you see, we can be everywhere. Ah, this French. So he succeeded in these missions, and when he defeated these two forts, the winter was not very far to come. And but many, many people from the forts or all around, they escape when they saw the French arriving. They escape inside. So La Perouse decided to destroy totally the fort. And he realized that when he would leave, the guys he defeated and who escaped, they would die, they would starve, they would be maybe killed by the local people, and so they were in danger. So he decided, before leaving, to let some food and to let some guns and munitions, just in order to help the guys who escape to survive. So this is always in this philosophic concept. And he was, of course, he got a reputation with the English, not only because he fought them many times, but because he was really a gentleman. At the end of the war, so he got, of course, he was recognized by the American, and he was done a member of the Cincinnati Society. So this is also a very experienced seaman at this time in 83, a very experienced seaman, a leader ready for other adventures. But at this time, Louis XVI, the king, he was fed up of this fight. He was fed up because once again, in this siècle des Lumières, Louis XVI realized that we couldn't solve the problems only by fighting. We had to behave differently, particularly with English people. So he said, we have to stop. And also, he was quite pragmatic, because all these wars that were done before cost a lot of money. So France was almost bankrupt at this time. France lost a lot of colony that English took from France, as Canada, for instance. And Louis XVI decided to restart the business, the French business. He decided instead of going to in a war again, he decided to start the business all around the world. So he wanted to have someone who would go all around the world to explore the world, to see where there are some possibility of trading, to try to make a better knowledge of the entire world. Because at this time, once again, Diderot, D'Alembert were building what we call l'encyclopédie. L'encyclopédie is this amount of knowledge that was put, that was gathered in a big, big book, in many books, because they wanted at this time to collect all the knowledge of humanity, to put in books and to put at the disposal of everybody. So it was a big, big project, and so Louis XVI asked La Perouse to be the leader of this expedition. And this expedition, of course, had to go all around the world, and even the military or politicians, they were fighting together in all the countries in Europe. We have to know that the scientists of all the world all the Europe at least, they were connecting together and working together. And this is how the Royal Academy of London will help this expedition. They, La Perouse will get a lot of information about Cook who died in 1779 in Hawaii. So La Perouse will get all his journals, all his writings, the charts and things. So he will get also from the English some navigational instrument, because at this time there was a big, big problem. We could fix the position on the Earth by the latitude. It was not a problem. But the longitude was very difficult to fix, because you need the time. You need to have the proper time to fix the positions of the stars and so. And if you have not the proper time, you have not a proper position. So it was a strategic matter. And even the English will help the French to do it. And this is the English who will solve the issue some years later. But you see, so with all the scientists and philosophers all around Europe, there was really something in common, and they were all working together. So Louis XVI will ask to La Perouse to exactly fix the position of the Hawaii Islands, because Hawaii Islands had a strategic position. In fact, you can see here Hawaii in the middle of the Pacific. So it's very useful to cross from Asia to America. It's very useful because the ships can stop there to get water, to have some wood, to repair the ship. So you have to know exactly where are this island. You have to get exactly the position. And there was, particularly with the Dutch and Spanish, there was a trick. They knew where were many islands or countries, but they were giving to their friends some wrong positions. Because if you get the right position, you are the one who know exactly where you can go, through which passage you can sail. But if you have not the knowledge, exact knowledge of the position of all these islands and so you have more difficulties. So the purpose of this expedition was to solve a lot of these questions and to put in the encyclopedia this chart for the benefit of everybody. There was also a part that was not very well known, all this island in the Pacific. There was no knowledge about this, so La Perouse has to work on this, to discover the island, to see what's going on here, and to fix their position. He had to fix an issue also, to fix here find out if there was a passage between the China and the Sakhalin Island, to go from China Sea up to the Sea of Okhotsk. This is just here. And the other strategic point was to try to find the Grand Passage, what we call the Passage of Northwest. The Passage of Northwest, because to go from Europe to Pacific, so we had to go or south of Africa and cross Indian Ocean, and it was a shorter to go from Europe and try to cross the America from one side or another one. So the Cape Horn was discovered in 1616, the Magellan Strait in 1520, so it was quite early discovered and practiced, but after in the north there was nothing. And we had a French navigator from Saint-Malo, my home city. I'm proud of him. Who in 1534 was already looking for this passage of Northwest. And it was, and finally, this French guy, Jacques Cartier, ended in the Saint Laurent River. He never found the passage. This passage in Northwest was discovered by Amundsen in 1906. So we had to wait for a long, long time. So he had also as a mission, this is to describe the population, describe nature, describe all the plants, the animals he could meet during this expedition. So for this purpose, he will receive two ships. And at the opposite of many, many explorers before him, he will not use a warship. He will use a commercial ship. Because in a commercial ship, they are more maneuverable and they can carry a lot of goods inside their holds. So they can carry a lot of spare parts, they can carry a lot of fresh water, food, and bring back from the country he will visit it, bring back a lot of stuff that will be given to the scientist in France, that will be described and put in the encyclopedia. So he will go to in this expedition with two very suitable ships. And so we have La Boussole and L'Astrolabe. They are these two ships. And quite small because they are both almost the same, 40 meters long. This is 120 feet long. So they are going to sail for 3 years on such a small boat. And I show you here, this is a model, ship's model that has been done in Albi, just to show you the structure of the ship. You can see this is not absolutely not the structure of a conventional warship, but definitely she is totally fit to carry, transport a lot of goods. So here they will have lot of material. And they will have on board, because once again, they are not military ships, but they will have some scientists on board. They will have, on each ship, they will have 110 people. 110 people on 120 feet long. And they are going to be for 3 years altogether. Yeah, it's a little bit a squeeze, huh? And I hope that someone doesn't smell too much from the feet, or because it's... So they will be 110 on one, 113 on the other one, and they will have some meteorologists, some astronomers, some physicians, some scientists, some doctors, medicines, and some translators, some botanists, and some specialists of the clock at this time. You remember, we wanted to build a clock that is able to stand the motion of a ship. And that's very, very difficult. So this is a long trip to do. And so they are sailing from France in 1784, August 1784. And they will sail all along the coast of, they will cross the Atlantic Ocean. They will sail all along the east coast of South America, passing Cape Horn, going to Chile, then to Easter Island, and every time documenting. They will stop in Hawaii, and from Hawaii, they go straight to Alaska. And because of the notes he got from Cook, the expeditions of Cook, he will try to reach the Mount St. Elias, because Mount St. Elias is one of the highest in this area that is very remarkable. We can see it from very far, so it's a good indication for the sailor. So he will try to reach this position. So in June 1786, so he will reach the coast of Alaska. So here, near Yakutat, and this is almost what he did, he saw. Because he's writing that as the fog was lifting, so we could suddenly see the long mountain, chain of a mountain with a lot of snow. And he recognized, finally, the Mount St. Elias above the clouds, exactly like this, where we can see here. So this is almost what saw La Perouse when he arrived in June 1786. So he arrived along the coast, he approached the coast and start to sail, so eastward along the coast, until he reached Yakutat Bay. He dropped anchor at the place that is now named as Point Mambi. For those of you who know, Point Mambi in near Malaspina Glacier. And he will send some small boats to try to discover the area, and as he was instructed to make a measurement, to observe, to try to find some people, to find the famous passage of Northwest. Is this the door to the Northwest? So he will try to explore the Yakutat Bay. He will give to, so of course, no passage to Northwest, otherwise we would know it now. No passage to Northwest, and so he decided to continue his trip, eastbound, and before leaving, he will name this bay as Monty Bay. And this is why now in Yakutat you have a small bay that is still named as Monty Bay. He will continue to sail all along the coast. And sailing all along the coast, he will see some people. He will see some people. He will see some smoke from some village or whatever. But he tried to stop and to land, but it was impossible for him. The swell was too strong. The coast was not good for good enough for these ships to approach the coast. So he continued until very end of June, when he reach the entrance of Lituya Bay. So of course at this time he doesn't know that this is Lituya Bay, he doesn't know what it is, so he will stop in front of this entrance and he will send some small boat to explore the bay. And this is the beginning of a long story. So at first, the native have a long tradition and a story about the European coming, as when they saw these two sailing boats coming, they were thinking that the raven was coming back. And of course, they were not allowed to look straight to the raven, and so they took, what was the name of it? Skunk cabbage, huh? Yeah, and to look not at the raven, but what they were carrying, this kind of basket or long boat where there were some small people. So avoiding to look at the sail. And when the ships approached, so they sent someone on board and they realized that these human people that maybe were sent by the raven, they had some strange habits. They were drinking blood, eating worms and so, because the French were drinking wine, it's well known, and eating rice. So it was unknown for the native. And so when he came back, he had a kind of a negative report about these people. But however, they decided to welcome them. And La Perouse, on his side, he sent his boat inside the bay. And when the small boats, as they came back to the big ship, the report was quite positive. So the guys, they say, no, it's very good. It's very sheltered. It's protected. There is fresh water. There is wood. There are plenty of people fishing. So it's full of fish here. And maybe we can do business with the native. And La Perouse said, yes, but I'm not confident with the entrance of this bay. I'm not confident because it's very narrow and it seems to have some current. And he will say, okay, so I go to sleep, we will see tomorrow. And no, he didn't sleep at all during the night because he was thinking, I go, I don't go, I go, I don't go. And the officers, they were pushing him, yes, we have to go, we have to go. And so, and finally, in the early morning, so La Perouse said, Ali, okay, we go, we try. And the two ships started to approach the entrance of the bay. But they were just approaching, so they launched again the small boats, as you can see, to make a kind of a channel to be protected from the rocks. And when the two ships enter, suddenly the wind is changing. The current becomes more strong, and the ship cannot be maneuverable anymore. And so they are just carried by the water. They are drifted by the water inside the bay, but at a quite a high speed. So they were very close, you see, to run aground. And La Perouse will be frightened. He will be scared. So anyway, now they are inside the bay. This picture has been painted by Mark Meyer. And he tried to do it as an authentic fact. And this is why you can see the sail. They are not normal for a sailing boat. The sail should be on the other way. Here they are like this because there is no more wind, and this is just because they are pushed ahead. So they escape they avoid a big catastrophe, because what would have happened if the two ships disappeared in this condition. Anyway, they enter in Lituya Bay, and they started to make their observation. As you can see, they do the mapping of the area with some triangulation system, and they got a quite efficient result. This is the drawing of the bay. And this is the U.S. Coast Guard, the NOAA chart. So you can see it's very similar. So they were doing a pretty good job. They were doing a pretty good job, and they chartered all the area. And they started to meet people, to observe the nature, the animals, and so, and to explore. So it will be now interesting to realize the relationship between the people. So they describe we can see some ursine here, and all this will go in the encyclopedia. So it helps to understand how is the life in this area, and it describes also the people who are living there, who are living or who are presently there. And we can see now the different people trading together, and La Perouse will write about this fact that for him, it seems that the people never lived permanently there, but they were coming in, coming out, and many, many new people coming, and he was suspecting that there was a big trading commercial activities between the natives. So apparently, if we look carefully on this design on this sketch, you can see that people have different clothes, different attires. And this is a picture of more than 200 years ago. This is a picture that is interesting to try to understand people, and for all of us now it's a look backward on more than 200 years ago. He will describe people, and I have to say that La Perouse was not, in his judgment, a very nice guy. Of course, there were some issues between native and European, and French. The French, they had the iron, and the native hadn't iron. They were working with copper. They had, this was their richness. And when the native saw the iron of the French, so they tried to catch some of it, and it was quite annoying for the French. So there was quite tension between all of them. And La Perouse will write some very bad things about people in there. Even he was in the spirit of the enlightenment of the philosopher and so, but La Perouse, so he was just a man, just with his weakness, his force and so. So he gave not very nice description, but on the more scientist point of view, you see, he tried to understand people. He tried to understand what could be common between all people all around the world. So he made this kind of test all around the world. And you see these numbers, very simple. He gave to all people he is visiting, he gives them this number, and he writes after how they are talking. After, he will compare this result from one country to another country to try to see if there are some similitude between the language, if there are some relationship between different people. I remind that we are only in the 18th century. So it's a long, long time ago. For us, many things are obvious now, but at this time, this was very important questions. He will even try to understand how people they are talking, and all around the world. But here, the advantage we have, it is clearly documented. It is written how people, they express some sounds, how they express some letters. So this will help a lot of the scientists after to try to understand what can be common in the humanity. He will also record, because of course he has not his mobile or his recorder, so he will record on his way different songs all around the world. And this is a Tlingit song that has been recorded. This is a song of 220 years ago. So this is quite interesting to, as a memory, I would say interesting for us European, because I know that the natives have another way to keep memories of things. This is the oral tradition that we transmit from generation to generation. But in Europe, we are as we are. We are more a Google Google traditions. We are tradition of writing everything, put on books, and to put to at the disposal of everybody. It will describe some, you see the canoe. So this canoe, he found this one, and talking, it was not easy to talk, but the native explained him that a few days before La Perouse arrived, so there was a group of 8 canoes, like this one, who entered Lituya, and 7 of them sunk. 7 of them sunk with many people on board. So the survivors, they erected the only canoe that survived, they erected as a monument. This is what La Perouse was thinking. And La Perouse was going pop-up to try to figure out how it was built, what it was. And of course, it was an offense for people, for local people. But La Perouse didn't know because he was in the European mental way. So you see, without bad intention, of course, he was offending the local people, native. So this highlights that many people, they are together, they are fighting, but it's not because of bad intention, but because of lack of knowledge of each of people together. And this is a matter of a lot of misinterpretation. If we don't know very well the other one, yes, we always can make some mistakes between all of us, and we can have misunderstanding, and we can be offended also. This is another drawing of this time about this canoe. And we have, for European, we have the picture of what was going on more than 200 years ago. This is a village that is described by La Perouse, a village. And La Perouse, when he sees this, he realizes that it cannot be a permanent village. It cannot be a permanent village because it's too light, it's not well protected against the rain, the snow, or whatever. And he will write, La Perouse will write in his journal that he saw many, many canoes that were bringing all their houses, material, and going in, going out from Lituya Bay. So he was thinking that most probably this was not a permanent an area where people were living permanently. So, of course, La Perouse never go in the inside passage. He never go inside the coast, inside the shore. So he never saw the long houses. La Perouse never saw a totem. So La Perouse couldn't understand the richness of the society, of the the native society. He couldn't understand their organization. He couldn't understand the symbolism of these people. So he missed totally all the richness of these local people, only because he was passing very far. So he didn't understand at all this complexity and the richness of this society. So as I said, many issues are coming from misunderstanding. And for La Perouse, as for Cook or for many, many explorers at this time, let's remember 200 years ago, even more, you are coming as European, you are coming in a place, and you say, okay, there is a nice forest, and okay, I have just to take the wood, I have just to take the water, I have just to take this, pop, 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 and I have just to pick up what I want. But without realizing that, same as in France we have some land that are property of some people, they didn't realize that there were inland where that could be owned by some local people. Of course, he didn't know the society. He didn't know the way of life of people. He didn't know them at all. So he took wood, he took water, he took whatever he could, the fish and so, without asking any permissions. So you see, by the lack of knowledge, so he made, of course, a lot of mistakes. So he was taking a lot of things on the, specifically on the this island. And to avoid any conflict, so there was some issues with the native. So as La Perouse wrote in his journal, he wrote that a local chief proposed to him to buy this island. So in this way, if he buy this island, he would be the owner. so he can take for the native, so he could take whatever he wants on this island. And La Perouse, he said, I'm not sure he's the real owner of this island, but at least I will be quiet and I can do whatever I want. So with two people who do not understand together, they got an agreement. La Perouse gave some money, he settled on the island, and he could do whatever he wants. Of course, when La Perouse left, who would know that he bought the island? For sure, he was not expected to come back for a long time. Anyway, so he installed the expedition on this island, so known as a Cenotaph Island. Installed the expedition, and they did some astronomical measurement to fix the clock. They repaired the ship. They took off everything from inside the ship, and they put ashore in order to clean the inside of the ship. Because I told you, 100 people, it smelled a little. And to get rid of the humidity that that was in the hold. So they refit everything. They did their experiences. They did what they had to do. They did their job. And they were of course at anchor in this part. And the 13th of July. So La Perouse said, it's time to go. It's time to go because he still has a long trip to do all around the world. But he remembered how it was tough, how it was difficult to come in inside the bay. He remembered the story of the native, of the 7 canoes that capsized. So he decided to send again some small boats. And at the entrance of the bay, in this area, to check the depth and to check where are the rocks, because you can see in all these areas is full of rocks. So he wanted to charter this specifically, and he said to these boats, you go there, but be careful to the current. As soon as there is a little bit of current, please go away. Come back immediately. So happened what happened. The three small boats, they go early morning, they go to the entrance, and they start to make their job, when suddenly one boat is caught by the current. Then a second one, and the third one wants to help the other one. And basically, the three boats are caught by the current and inside this passage. Two of them capsized. And one survived and is thrown away, is a kick away in the ocean. So these two boats who capsized, 21 people were on board. And they disappeared. So you remember 110 on one boat, 113 on the other one. So 21 disappeared. This is almost 10% of the expedition who passed away, who were suddenly drowned. So of course, it's a big disaster and big drama. Big drama, of course, and they will stay some more time in Lituya Bay to try to find the bodies or some survival eventually, but no way. So after this disaster, so they realized that the native came to see the French and trying to help the French to find some people, but once again, the 21 guys totally disappeared. So La Perouse tried, in a way, to escape from Lituya Bay, because now he's trapped inside. He's trapped, and he don't know how to go away. He has to wait the very, very favorable moment when there is not too much wind, not too much current, no fog, nothing, the perfect weather condition. So from the 13th of July, he will have to wait until the 30th of July. He will stay 17 days trapped in this bay. One thing he will do before leaving on Cenotaph Island, so this island belongs to him, so he will erect a monument in memory of this 21 people. He will erect a monument, and this is why the island has been named as a cenotaph, because cenotaph comes from the Greek kenos, typhon, that means empty tomb, because there is nobody to put in the tomb. So he erected a monument and said this island will be called as Cenotaph Island. That is still the name for the European. So he erected a monument. And here I wanted to make a parenthèse. This is the robe that has been woven by Terry Rothkar. Terry Rothkar, who wove this robe about Lituya, where she made many symbols about the strength, about the force of Lituya, about the spirit of Lituya, and where she did put here l'astrolabe and la boussole. So I had the honor to meet Terry 12 years ago, and I would like this afternoon to have a special thought for her. And she will always stay in our memories. So this, so La Perouse finally succeed to escape from Lituya Bay the 30th of July, and he will continue his job. He will continue to charter, to make the map of the Alaskan coast. And he will sail, so from Lituya now, down to San Francisco. And he will do this job. And of course, I did the comparison between the actual map of NOAA and the ones of La Perouse, where we can find, of course, a lot of similitudes. So, of course, there are many things that are written on the La Perouse chart, as all these mountains, because at this time there was no radar. So, for them, the only way to have a good position, this was to fix the position by doing some bearings with the mountains or some peaks or some entrance of the bay. So we have here many, many charts, and there are two charts here actually waiting for be presented. And I wanted to also to highlight this particularity of Lituya Bay. Most of you, I'm sure you know already this bay. You can see the description that was done in 1786. And La Perouse writing in his journal that this was more than 1 mile long here. And after 1 mile, he found five glaciers. One here, one here, one here, and one here, and one here. And what is interesting now, when we are talking about global warming, this is to realize that the glacier has totally filled this this place. So we can see that Lituya Bay is not a very quiet place at it seems to be. And in fact, we all know that there is all this succession of faults all along the coast, American coast and Asia, due to the fact of the Pacific plague, that plate that is hitting the America, North America plate, and where there is a subduction effect at the level of Alaska. So thus the result on Alaska, this is to lift up Alaska, and this is why we have this very high mountain that is that are lifted up by the action of the Pacific plate hitting the North one, North America one. We can see all this fault, and we can see that here Yakutat, and here somewhere is Lituya Bay. And this is, this one is more accurate, and you can see that the Fairweather fault is passing just on the extremity of Lituya Bay. So this is very interesting, because so you know better than me that you feel the earthquake sometimes. I never felt one because I'm living in France. And we are quiet in this part. And so the Fairweather fault is passing exactly in this bar. So, of course, there are a lot of energy in this bay. And one very documented fact happened in July 1958. Most probably because of an earthquake, but a big part of this mountain was detached from it and fell down in the water. This huge part of the mountain so fell down here, and what happened when it reached the water? What did the water? It comes up, and it came up to here, to the elevation of, I'm not very clever between US and French measurements. In French, it is 524 meters high. This is more or less 1,500 feet high. The water washed literally the mountain, just the opposite mountain. I have a few pictures here that have been given to me by Alan Chattuck from Juneau. And I want to thank him for this. This is what you see here. You can see that now there is not a single tree. It has been totally washed. And this point is 1,500 feet high. This picture was taken in August, 1 month after the incident. And we can see all the debris all around the bay. And we can see all along the bay, on an elevation of 30 meters, so 90 feet high, all the vegetation has been swept away. On this day, there were three boats who thought they were sheltered, they were quiet in Lituya Bay. One disappeared, one succeeded to escape, and one was carried by the wave of 30 meters high, 90 feet high. She was carried by the wave, and she was sent away in the ocean above the entrance of the bay. So it has been really documented because this guy was a native. Excuse me, but I don't have his name in my mind now. And this picture has been taken less than 10 years ago. And we can still see the discoloration here of the nature, where we have a new nature, and up to here also. So Lituya Bay is not such a quiet place as La Perouse could think. And now I would like to have also a thought to our friend Ron Klein, who is actually recovering from big injuries. And he found on this cenotaph island something very interesting, a big rock. Big rock, well shaped, and thinking that it might be something from La Perouse, why not? In fact, why not? When we look at the chart, you remember La Perouse erected a monument, the famous cenotaph. We never found it, never. We don't know where is it. So the idea is maybe this rock on the top of Cenotaph Island could be the cenotaph, this monument. In fact, it is placed exactly here. Exactly here. And what is interesting, because as a seaman, I took different measures, and I realized that when you are on a ship, on a boat, when you enter the entrance of the bay, when you can see this point aligned with this one, and aligned with this one, you are safe to turn because here there are some shallow waters. So the idea is maybe this is the cenotaph that could have been erected by the French to commemorate the memory of these 21 people who lost their life. And it could be, on the same hand, a landmark to safely enter Lituya Bay. This is proposition. So it is interesting. Lituya Bay has many, many secrets. And what we are always trying to do and think about, this is to honor the memory of this 21 people who have no tomb, so whose souls are running around Lituya Bay without being able to rest. They have exactly the same issue that so many natives who lost their lives in Lituya Bay. So at least, unfortunately, this event built a link between this expedition, between these people and the native. Once again, I had many times the great pleasure to meet Terry. And once again, I want to thank her for the passion she gave me for Alaska. I have the great pleasure to meet her, to meet Jackie, to meet Kathy, to meet John Baldry, to meet Ron Klein, to meet many, many people, and so apologize for the one I don't name. But I met so many friends in Alaska, and this is because of Lituya Bay. And this is Lituya Bay who put us all together from France up to Alaska. Well, this is I tried to make of a long story a short story, and I have to stop, otherwise this evening I can still talk about Lituya Bay, but I have a boat waiting for me. Thank you for all of you. So if you have any questions, so I will be pleased to try to answer, and maybe Jackie, if there are some questions, maybe you can help me as a native. Yes, please.
I've read a number of things about Lituya Bay, and I have some questions. I was told, I read that one of the people who La Perouse considered to bring along on the expedition was a young lieutenant in the military school in Paris, he decided not to bring them along, but that Napoleon Bonaparte was considered for this voyage. And I don't know if that is true, but I...
You imagine if Napoleon Bonaparte would have been in this expedition, the English would have been so quiet after. So it is a legend. We don't know exactly if it's true or not, but you are perfectly right. It is something that is said, that is commonly accepted. Yeah. As another anecdote that is very often said, this is when Louis the 16th was going on the guillotine. This was a French specialty at this time. When he was going on the guillotine, his last question was, do we have any news from La Perouse? Because La Perouse vanished, disappeared in 1788. And for 3 years, because Louis the 16th was guillotined on the 21st of January 1791, so for 3 years, he had no news of this expedition. He personally launched. So for him, this was, the failure of his life. For Louis XVI, it was a big concern for him. But he failed, poor man.
Did the French return to the
Bay? No. Who would like to come back after this? I am the only one, maybe. Crazy enough, as we can be. No French came back. No, because after that, there was the revolution in France. And after, when Napoleon, in the very early 19th, Napoleon took the power in France. So what did he do? He sold to America. He sold the Louisiana, because he said, if I have some properties abroad that are claimed between the American and English, again, so he would have a lot of difficulties to defend his territory. So he preferred to sell the Louisiana to the America. So it was not to build another. So after the French, they turned into colonies some other countries, as in Asia, as in Vietnam or whatever, Algeria. And they never came back here. Yes, indeed. But it took more than 1 year for him to reach France, because he had to cross by sled all the Kamchatka and after all Siberia and up to reach Moscow and then go to Saint Petersburg, because at this time Saint Petersburg was the capital of. And after from St. Petersburg, he had to come back to Paris. And it was during the French Revolution. So it had not the impact it could have get if we were still in a peaceful time. So the impact was much later, as we were talking before. The impact now is more about how La Perouse disappeared. And this is what is a little bit a pity, because people, they don't pay attention to what he did. They don't pay attention to what he described, what was so interesting. So all this knowledge that has been sent to France hasn't been exploited. Analyzed, yes, and they didn't took profit of it as they could have done. Yeah, because after the revolution, after there was Napoleon, and they focused more on the Egypt at this time, beginning of 18th, Napoleon sent a campaign to Egypt with this was the start of the Egyptology.
Thank you.
And so the Lituya Bay was not so so much interesting, yeah. Thank you to everybody. Thank you for your attention. I hope and I'm sure it's still sunny outside.